Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure. Oh, glory, glory, oh, glory, glory.
Hands to the heavens, no man, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposition in us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walk through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we woman and man up. They say stay down, and we stand up. Shots, we on the ground. The camera panned up. King pointed to the mountaintop, and we ran up.
One day, when the glory comes.
Good morning. Welcome to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. You know my voice already. It's Leyvon Miller. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you so much for letting me join you. I don't know what you guys are doing on this Friday at 11, but whatever it is that you do do, I'm happy that you're doing that do and that you've decided to do that do with me. It's a Friday. The people, them tired of working. Ba-dum. All right. There's a whole lot of things that are going on around here. I'm going to just leave the lines open because there's so much news going on. I know you all are at home reading your newspapers and seeing the things that are happening. And you have some thoughts. You may want to know what my thoughts are. I want to hear your thoughts on the things that you think when you thought about them. The cabinet is selected, and let me just say that all you need to do is be able to tie a yellow necktie, and you could be in the cabinet. All you need to do, if you can tie a half a Windsor, we don't even need you to be able to tie a whole Windsor. As a matter of fact, some of these neckties look like boat ropes to me, but you only need to be able to tie a knot. And once you can do that, you can now be in the cabinet of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. I do not have any clue in my mind why we need a cabinet this size. I also don't know why a 70-year-old man would want to watch this amount of people. 22 members in the cabinet, another seven members of parliamentary secretaries. That is a whole lot of people to watch. And let me tell you where I think problem comes in, right? The problem comes in when you consider the LOI. You remember the LOI? That Charles Thompson signed. Anyway, so because parliamentary secretaries have signing power, and ministers of state have signing power, ministers have signing power, right? Of course, all in different categories at different levels with different things that they are allowed to sign in their own realm of power. I don't know if I would want the job of watching that many people if I were prime minister. I also don't know if I would want to rely on putting my minister in such a precarious position, particularly because as the world opens back up, ministers will be doing some traveling. I see the prime ministers getting ready to travel. I just want to say, chief, I have a passport in the event you need, you know, I'm not really sure, but UN sounds pretty decent. Never been to the UN. I definitely don't have a problem with going. And guess what? I always keep a bag packed, so literally I need no notice. I don't have a wife, so there's nobody that will tell me I can't go. And, you know, my support-based system is wonderful in Nassau. Everything will stay afloat in my absence. Outside of that, who knows? Maybe I could do the show from the UN summit. That'll be wonderful. You see how this all is working together so well? I like the way this sounds. Yeah, so, but outside of that, this cabinet, I cannot justify this for the prime minister. I cannot make this make sense in my mind, particularly since only months ago, members of the Progressive Liberal Party were calling for a pay cut for members of parliament. It's kind of tongue-in-cheek then to see that kind of language coming out of the party, only to then see a 22-member cabinet appointed. That is ungodly, if you ask me, quite honestly. I had predicted that he would go with 15 because I believe he wants to have the semblance, if you will, of a new day. I believe he wants to have the semblance of a man that saw the folly of the things of the past and has come to revitalize, revisit, and restructure. They don't really know what dream he had when he thought that this would go off very smoothly with the Bahamian people. But this is going to be the first critique, I imagine, that the news people will take on with him, that members of the opposite side will take on with him, and even his detractors in politics will take on against him. I cannot make it make sense. I take no position at this time. Maybe there's method to the madness, like former Commodore Clifford Scavalla would say. Maybe there is method to this madness. I don't know. There are just interesting picks, you know, like I said yesterday, that if you have a cabinet this big, I imagine you would separate housing and transportation if the cabinet's going to be this big. So that's kind of unusual to me, and we will see what happens. If you have a cabinet this big, I would imagine that you'd give the public service its own minister and not share it with the minister that's going to be out of the country for 60% of his tenure. Granted, you gave him a minister of state, but I'm just saying, I mean, if you're going to have a 22-member cabinet, there are just some things that I would imagine would go in their own portfolio. Why? Why the public service? Well, first of all, think about it. There's the Bahamas Public Service Union. There's about 1,000 other unions associated with the public service. And all of those unions have working arrangements and working agreements. You hear Wesley. Mr. Ferguson. Kingsley Ferguson. You hear him out there griping about how the government was, you know, a couple completed and they kind of walked away from the table right before elections, and that kind of bothered them. So there's any number of reasons why you could have a ministry as big as the public service underneath its own portfolio. There's a lot of amendments to be done. There are a lot of people that are inactive. There are a lot of people that need to become inactive. There are people that need to retire. There are people that need to be employed. And so I would give that to a minister by itself if I had a 22-member cabinet. But for whatever it's worth, the prime minister, in his wisdom, has gone with that. And so I say again, all you need to be able to do is tie half a Windsor. One half of a Windsor. You don't even need to be able to tie the whole thing. It has to be a yellow Windsor, though. As long as you could tie a yellow Windsor, you could be in the cabinet at the bottom. It's like an Oprah Winfrey show. I just feel like you get a cabinet post, and you get a cabinet post, and you sitting all the way in the back there, you get a cabinet post! Oh my God! That's how I feel when I was watching the swearing-in ceremonies the other day. But they were quite regal and resplendent. I must say that the PLP is certainly picked better. That's not appropriate to say. Let me think about how I want to say this. Looking at PLP spouses, it has come to my realization that many of the persons that happen to have been selected for Public Liberal Party obviously picked spouses for where they thought their lives would end up rather than where their lives were at the moment of the matrimony. Is that better, Kermit? Is that more smooth? Sometimes you look at the spouses and you wonder to yourself, what exactly did you think you would end up as in life? And I have to admit that when I look at PLP spouses, they just look like spouses for where we are today and not necessarily where we were when we fell in love. Okay? That's smooth. I think I can get away with that one. And so they were quite regal. They were resplendent. And so I want to commend them on that. You can call me 323-6232-325-4316, 325-425-9, right? And I have a message for the former prime minister. Man, let it go, Louis, all right? Just let it go. You don't need to be the leader of opposition. You don't need to be the leader of the party. Come to the parliament, touch the Bible, take your oath, stand to your feet, say, Mr. Speaker, I am pleased. Having sat in this place for 15 years, realizing that I sat under the second and the third prime minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, I have had great privilege to lead this great Commonwealth, one of the largest economies in our region, for a period of just shy of 5 years. It has been my life's joy. It has been the journey of my life, the unimaginable in many instances. And in some instances, Mr. Speaker, could not in my life's wildest dream imagine that this little Bain Town boy who walked the streets en route to St. Augustine's College many mornings, sometimes braving the elements, that I, a medical doctor, would be given this opportunity to lead these great people in this great Commonwealth as their greatest prime minister and fourth prime minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Mr. Speaker, it is with that in mind, like Sir Lyndon Pinling once said, that the voice of the people is in fact the voice of God. And if God has ever spoken in such a fashion, I believe that on September 16, he spoke in a loud, rumbling voice. And I wish now to tell the people of the Bahamas and the ancestors of the Commonwealth that I, Hubert Alexander Minnis, have heard the people's voice. Subsequently, I believe that I have also heard the voice of God. Mr. Speaker, I am pleased to announce that after only having 5 prime ministers in the history of this country, there are only 2 that will have this chance, and that is to voice their resignations on the floor of this august chamber. I now tender my resignation, not only as a member of the Free National Movement, but I tender my resignation, Mr. Speaker, as a member of this House, and I resign my seat this day. This will be the last time my voice will be heard. He can steal a line from Bicewell too. I've breathed my last political breath, and I shall now turn my back and point my head towards the sunset. And as the sun sets, so does it set on my political career. I wish only for the Commonwealth good peace, health, and tranquility, the prosperity that we promised them when we penned our Constitution, that none of them, Mr. Speaker, shall ever have their lives deprivated. And although removed from public life, it is still going to be my life's sojourn to ensure that every man, every woman, every boy, and every girl in this Commonwealth knows and understands that we are free people, that we are one people, that we are one Bahamas. With that, Mr. Speaker, I take my seat. And then you leave and you just let it go, Louis. All right? Let's take a phone call. Good morning, caller. You're on. Not there. Next one. Good morning, caller. You're on. Caller, you there?
Good morning, Leyvon. How are you?
I feel good. How are you?
Thank you. The cabinet size is large, but I think with so many newbies there, which we call them the rookies, new people,
mm-hmm.
I think they need an opportunity to work along with the seasoned ministers
mm-hmm.
to learn. And I think in another year or maybe 2, you can see a winding down or a dropping off. And by the way, Leyvon, with the 8 months difference with the 2022 elections, like would have been next year sometime.
Yeah, about 8 months, yeah.
Yeah, so that salary will I guess that's a little different for that. They'll be able, you know, if how they go on for the full 5 years, those cabinet ministers will be getting that. So I try to look for the positive spin on that.
I don't know. I'm still trying, but I it's difficult.
With your friend Dr. San,
mm-hmm.
Dr. Wayne San, I feel as if with this rivalry between him and Dr. Minnis, I truly believe Dr. Minnis really, really, really is trying to hold on to that opposition leader position.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, they have to appoint. I don't know how many they get to appoint.
4 senators.
In the Senate. Mm-hmm. In the Senate, sorry. I think he's trying to. I'll be shocked if he appoints Dr. San to the Senate. Had it been a new leader of the opposition,
mm-hmm.
they would have been able to appoint Dr. San. Because as a senator, being involved in the parliamentary procedures, he would have been able, I think, in a better position
mm-hmm.
to run or, you understand?
I believe, I'm going to say this to you, surely flesh and blood had not revealed that to you. Surely it was the Lord that had revealed that to you. And I believe the very same thing, that yes. This is all in an attempt to out the fire, not on Dr. Sands, you know, but on Hubert Alexander Ingram. And so he knows Sands is Ingram's guy. Yeah. He's making sure when he leaves, the legacy and the influence of Hubert Ingram is no more. And so he's making sure that he kills Ingram's guy, which is Sands.
That was never an appetite. I don't think that's never.
But this is what I. I don't believe flesh and blood had revealed it to you. So I'm telling you, what I've gathered.
Yes, and then even if people have stepped down as the representative out in Killarney, the thing is the by election. I think they would the party would send Dr. Sand.
I don't think he resigns that seat for 2 years. I think he will resign as leader of the opposition. He will sit in the parliament. If you remember when Mr. Ingram was not leader of the opposition, but still a member of the Free National Movement, you know, you could count the days he came to parliament. I think Mr. Minister will do the same thing. He will only come to parliament enough to be counted on the register, which causes him not to have to vacate his seat. He'll drag it for 2.5 years, and after the 2 years is over, then he'll resign, and by then Dr. Sand should be somewhere in Tuskegee, probably, you know, doing procedures.
Yeah, but on politics or on I think that's my agreement. But you have a safe and a good weekend, Leyvon.
I'll try my best. Thank you very much. Let's take another one, Kermit. Let's go. Good morning, caller. You're on. Caller, there? Not there. Next line. Good morning, caller. You're on.
Good morning, Mr. Soldier.
Hey, how you doing, Berenice? Man, Berenice, you sound like you had a bad line. Let me read a couple of these text messages. I do have a song I want to play for the former Prime Minister, though, by Tony Braxton. Can we get to that, Kermit? Let's go to the song. Listen, Mr. Prime Minister, this is my song that I want to devote to you as you let the Lord use you, man. All of this FNMI's new leadership, Minister agrees not to seek top post in November convention and thing. See, because y'all ain't slick. I didn't know the plan, Kermit. He could say, I nominating. And then he could pull up to the convention and someone can nominate him from the floor. Y'all ain't smarter than me. I didn't figure y'all out. Mr. Just let it go, Louis. Just let it go. You 70. I'm not $14 million. I would be laying down naked on a beach somewhere with half-naked females fanning me with a palm branch, drinking water from a coconut. That's what I would be doing at 70. I wouldn't be worrying about no fat. I wouldn't be worrying about no poor people. As a matter of fact, if you said something that related to a government function to me at 70, I would use curse words in your direction. If I had $14 million. So, Mr. Prime Minister, former, just listen to Tony Braxton, right? Let it go and let it flow, my friend. Tony Braxton. Stop, just let it go.
Let it blow. Come. Everything's gonna work out right, you know. Just let it go. Woo. Let it blow. Just let it go, baby. Don't nobody want no broke heart. Don't nobody want no two-time losers. Oh, no. Ain't nobody gonna love me like you are if you take whatever he brings your way. Oh, no, no, no. See the thing of it, we deserve respect, but we can't demand respect with a chain. Comes a time when we must go our own way. Let love. Let it flow. Everything's gonna work out right, you know.
Just let it go, baby. Let it flow.
Just let it go. Oh, yeah. Sometimes love can work out right now. Sometimes you'll never know. You're never ever gonna know it. But if it brings you pain in your life, don't be afraid.
Human Menace, this has brought you pain, so just let it go, man. Seven seeds? You and the Restless Seven. Not you and the you is a part of the Restless Seven. You know, I saw an interview from Loretta Butler during, and she said, you know, they call us rebels. And now here you are, as a member of the Restless Seven. I just want to say, sometimes it's going to work out right. If it brings you pain, just let it go, Louis, okay? Don't listen to these people that keep telling you things like stay on. They lying to you. I telling you, I out here with the people, and the people them say, man, you know, We can check you later, Chief. Let's take another phone call. Good morning, caller. You're on. Not there. Next one. Good morning, caller. You're on. Is it there? Good morning, caller. You're on. Not there. Next call. Good morning, caller. All right, give me a call back. Let me knock out a couple of these text messages. This one here says, Leyvon, good morning. Instead of having a member walk and chew gum, we need two members, one to walk and one to chew gum. I guess. I can't. If 28 of the 32 seats that you won are all cabinet ministers and have to say yes, chief, every time you raise your hand up, I don't know how good is that for democracy. Halsin Muji, must he come in a spray with a fire hose if y'all think y'all can get away with that? Leyvon, good morning. Instead of having a member... Okay, I read that one already. This one here says, Davis is right back on the same road, giving out more cookies to his friends and party associates, creating more government jobs that our taxpayers have to pay for. Same old, same old. Very disappointing. This one says, Leyvon, you can't travel with the PM because that's what he got for Clint. I don't know. I mean, I want to say this. I have heard no word, any communication, any courtesy note, anything. I do not know anything about any appointment of anyone anywhere to do any job. Let me make sure that I put that emphatically. I state that for the record, okay? You could take that as my official position. The voice of the people is not the voice of God. In 1 Samuel, God told Samuel, listen to the voice of the people. They have rejected me, not you. If the voice of the people rejected God, how can it be the voice of God? I'll get into that one. That's another Bible study back and forward. I know the people also cried out for a king. And if you remember, it was the crying out of the people that activated God's hand that made Saul king. So even when the people say they want something, sometimes God just gives it to them so that they could ask for would be. And if you remember in Samuel 15:35, Jesus, God went back to Saul, to Samuel the prophet, and say, Samuel, you know something, my God, I repent and all that I had made Saul to rule over the people because Saul had turned away from me, etc., etc., etc. So sometimes it depends. It depends on how you read the scripture. The voice of the people is the voice of God. This one says, greatest show ever. Please email the speech to Mr. Bittis Kaiser. I'm going to work on that. Let's take a call, Kermit. Good morning, caller. You're on.
Hello. Good morning, Mr. Malone.
Hi.
How are you this morning?
I feel great.
Oh, well, I'm great. I'm great that this FNM government has gone and this is a new day.
Oh, bless
well,
the Lord.
Mr. Miller, listen to me.
Mm-hmm.
You also behemoth people got to give Mr. Brave Davis a chance, you know. Mm-hmm. Give him a chance. That's his cabinet, but he chose to pick. The FNM, those had their cabinet picked.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And we had to sit down and we had to relax and see what the FNM government was going to do for the country.
Mm-hmm.
So give Mr. Davis a chance, man. Give him a chance.
I with him, you know, I against him. I just, you have to excuse me, right? I happen to be a self-taught student of politics, right? So I read about political maneuvers. How did a leader in this place do it? How did a leader in that place do it? What is the benchmark standard for this thing, that thing, and the next thing? You get me?
Yes, but did you all complain when Minister Chris Cabinet?
Man, I was complaining. I thought 21 was too much. I thought 21 was too much. When Papa had 21, I thought that was too much. Christy had 19. I thought that was too much. Mm-hmm. I really don't understand how do they make the math, right? If Ingram said, we don't need a 41-member parliament because we don't have that kind of population, then why do we need a 28-member cabinet?
But Minister, listen here. Gilbert Ingram didn't have his time.
Mm-hmm.
Terry didn't have his time.
Mm-hmm.
Minister didn't have his time. This is Brave time now.
Oh, hallelujah.
Whatever Brave choose to do, I think it should be better.
You with him 100%.
Yeah, now something else I want to say now concerning
mm-hmm.
the FNM.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Minister's too ashamed right now to just want to get away and say, I resign. He wants to block Dwayne Sands from getting that leadership in that party. Because, listen now, he wants to keep his trolley's fellas, them who he can contact, who he can control, to be able to say, well, anyhow, when we do convention, this is who we're going with.
Mm-hmm.
But only he knows that, listen to me, it's a time when young people are supposed to take this course,
mm-hmm.
right? But the party right now needs, the FNM party needs to sit down with their seven members of parliament, sit down with Mr. Dwayne Sands, sit down and see what they can move forward because it's going to take a long time before the Bohemian people is going to trust them again.
I'll tell you what is interesting to me. The former
people is going to trust them no more.
The former prime minister said he loves creating opportunities for young people. That is
that
where
man
he
ain't do opportunity for nobody.
No, but hold on. I want to point something out. He said that is what excites him, right? Adrian Gibson, 38 or 9, I think it is. Shannon Dawn Cartwright, I think about 46. Adrian White. I think he's also about 46. Who else is in there? There's seven of them. Iram Lewis should be about, that should be about 56. And there's one more from Grand Bahama. Who is that? The next person from Grand Bahama. Crazy Thompson. So I'm trying to figure out if Minnesota at 69, 8.
She controlled the young fellas. They had a say in that party.
No, all I'm saying is this is his perfect opportunity to give opportunity to young people. And he ain't giving it to them now.
Because he controlled them. Realize this now. Only four cabinet ministers will stand up against Mr. Minnis because guess what? They were a little older. They were experienced. They was an interwoven minister, but those other cabinet ministers right there and a law minister messed this whole country up, and none of them had nothing to say. You know why? Because they was getting their bread butter. They was getting everything what they wanted. Okay?
All right, appreciate you,
Gordon. Come in, break, and how they leaving? Millionaire.
Well, I don't know if they leave us millionaires, but, you know, it's easy to come in, break. The Bahamas expensive, so let's see what happens. Let's give me another line, Kermit. Come on and call you, Ron.
Hey, good morning, Leyvon. How you doing?
I'm well, Anton. How are you?
I'm doing fine, thank you. I believe, in my humble opinion, when you're looking at this, but the cabinet wrong, right? I understand that there could be the concern as it relates to the check on Parliament, right? From that perspective. However, I also understand, looking at that consideration, that there could be the level of discipline where an actual law or the actual conventions isn't necessary because the executive keeps a check, would be satisfied with what they see happen as a result of that check, unlike the previous administration. But the main point that I want to end on that I called you to express is you would be able to, and saying that a cabinet is too large outside of that perspective I just explained is all relative because, Leyvon, at the end of the five-year term, if you find that the country's dire economic crisis has been reversed, if you find that the country's COVID-19 crisis, healthcare plan crisis, education, labor force crisis, et cetera, has been reversed and turned into positive, then, Leyvon, you would have gotten more than your value and more than the investment. And from an accounting perspective, the return on investment would have been more than adequate.
Okay, so I'm gonna write that off as hogwash. I'll tell you why. Because you have said before on my show, Anton, that you thought that the last cabinet was too big. One, this cabinet is seven members larger than that last one. Two, I hear the whole economic turnaround, and if the money is more, then it doesn't matter how many salaries you pay out. Okay, decent point. But are you saying to me that we cannot streamline a cabinet in a way where we could have 15 or 14 or 13 members make up the same kind of executive direction? It doesn't parties or political organizations do something called a parliamentary caucus, and isn't the considerations of the parliamentary caucus then taken into cabinet for consideration around executive decisions? That's the other thing. The second thing, or the third thing, is the reason why we have to always be mindful of the executive is because we don't want them fondling the liberties of the parliament, which is exactly what the last speaker kicked and hollered and screamed about, that the executives wants to pull the legislative along like a dinghy boat. And so I think that it is enough for the executive of the Bahamas, which is only one of the three pillars in the tri-pillar system, to have such an unfair advantage that they come with their agenda, and it already doesn't. It is already bad that the Bahamas votes the way that we do with very small oppositions, right? Now you have a government that cannot even purge itself because 28 of the 32 people that sit down risk losing their jobs on the instant that they vote no on any matter. So if the prime minister decided next week that he wanted to kill all babies, literally 28 people sitting down in that house would have to beat on the desk and say, hey, hey. All I'm saying to you, Anton, is people would take your contributions a whole lot more forcefully and fruitfully if you didn't look at them so mono when it came to the Progressive Liberal Party. It is hogwash to have a 28-member cabinet if you only won 32 seats. So I hear you. The prime minister has the luxury of doing whatever it is in his pleasure. that don't mean he should find pleasure in everything he does, though. You see the difficulty there? Yeah. All right, let's take another one. Good morning, Carly. You're on. Not there. Let me read another text message. Leyvon, do you think the Bahamian people could give the PLP an additional 8 months that Dr. Menes gave up so they can use that time to clean up the FNM mess? Nope, I don't think that's the way it works. So I am very disappointed in this government already. As a prudent Bahamian, I am extremely upset with this huge cabinet and its costs. I'm not giving no government a chance. I and dozens of Bahamians criticized the FNM from day one. No break wave crew. This one here says, Mr. Miller, the reality is the FNM has to go. The FNM has to get its act together. The PLP has a very deep leadership bench. If the PLP achieve half of their promises, Chester Cooper will be ready to take the baton. Too quick, Dr. Sands is brilliant, but Pintard is the dark horse. This one says, 1 Samuel 8:11. This is what the king who will reign over you will do. He will take your sons and make them serve with his chariots. This one here says, Mr. Miller, it is easier to watch your child when he is in your home cleaning your cabinet. Can you imagine your 70-year-old uncle trying to watch 21 of your children on an outside park? I can't imagine that. This one says, let's hear the Young and the Restless song again. Cartwright is 46, not 26. I said 46. I know he's 46. This one here says, good morning, Leyvon Miller. I must not say that I am surprised, but are you sure that you haven't been under the influence of some type of mind-altering substance since the BLP won? I'm not a fan of Mr. Menes, but it is immature and childish to suggest that Menes voluntarily relinquish. Let me make sure I read this because I feel like I'm going to have to respond to this. Relinquishes leadership of the FNM just because he lost one election. You need to let it go. It is his career, not yours. And if the FNM continues to vote for him to stay in leadership, that is their business. Voters do their talking with their votes. You seem to be headline hunting. Okay, I'm happy that you feel that way. I'm sorry that I couldn't massage you into a position that got you to agree with me. Notwithstanding, it is good Westminster practice that you resign if you lose. Particularly if you call an election 7 months early, which means you called it for your advantage and you disadvantaged the entire caucus because of your miscalculation. How do you even go around those? When they have the shrimp and cocktails, do they still invite you? Plus, there's been dissent in the party regarding you before you were even prime minister. You ascended to prime minister, and with all power and might in your hand, you still... Isn't that amazing? How are they permitting you to stay? You should leave. It is embarrassing. And I don't really care. I'm not a card-carrying member of the FNM or the PLP, no. But what I am is firstly a concerned citizen, and secondly, a talk show host who has the ability to read what's happening in the news and to dissect them. And from all indication, including the fact that people in your party, none less than the former leader, basically has said that you are the problem. I mean, just on humility alone, you should want to step aside, whether you were right or wrong. It is like your wife telling you that the reason why the house was taken and the light is off is because you is a no good husband when you was giving her the money the whole time, right? So you know what you do? You tell her, you know what, mess? You dead right. I leaving. I going to live by so fans. And let's see if the light can stay on when I leave. And if it doesn't stay on, then we know it wasn't you that was the problem. As it stands right now, though, he happens to be the sore that won't heal. And it's been 6 years now. Let's take a call. Good morning, Carly. You're on. I got to go to the break. Let's take a call. Good morning, Carly. You're on.
Good day to what?
Hey, what's up?
I'm all right, man. You know, should COVID-19 be a reason
No, let's go to the break, Kermit. Give me a call back, Carly. Your phone line's not good. Let's go to the break. Don't move. It's Leyvon Miller. I'm unleashed on your radio. That means it's somewhere between 11 and 12 o'clock. All I want to tell the former prime minister is let it go, Louie. Just let it go. We'll be back after this.
What happened to you?
You look like you lost your paycheck.
Oh man, I just realized I got scammed out of a bunch of money.
They said I won this contest and just needed me to send them some money so I could collect. I mean, to expedite something. Or was it to smooth the process?
Man, you're smarter than that. Protect yourself against scams and fraud by following these tips. If you know you didn't enter a competition, you can't win. Never play to receive a cash prize. If you're being asked, you're being scammed. Check trusted internet sites for verification of information given to you. Do not give your banking details to people you don't know. If it sounds too good to be true, it is. Monitor your bank account regularly for any questionable transactions.
Get more information at GetMoneySmartBahamas.com.
Hey, did you find the show interesting? Do you want to be a part of the conversation? Well, sponsor Unleashed today. Call 302-2304 or 302-2375 to see which package is right for you. Join Leyvon Miller as he ignites the passion of the next generation by bridging the gap with engaging conversations and innovative ideas. Take action and sponsor Unleashed today at 302-2304 or 302-2375 and be unleashed.
Here we go.
J.S. Johnson Insurance agents are the best. Reliable service, we've been on the scene, protecting since 1919. J.S. Johnson Insurance has the best. Always, you're always covered me. J.S.
Welcome back. Thank you for staying with me. Leyvon Miller here. It's Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Let me give you the phone numbers. 323-6232-325-4316. 325-4259. I don't know if I can say it any slower than that. That's about as slow as I could get it. You can text me on 422-4796. There's something else I want to talk about because I don't want to forget this as I'm going into the weekend, right? Crime should start going down around here. I say hip, 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 hooray. Hip, 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 hooray. Hip, 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 hooray. I'm so glad to see that obviously we have the best crime-fighting police in all of the whole Caribbean, and maybe definitely the archipelago for sure have all returned to work. It seems as though there was a wonderful little letter sent by the Commissioner of Police. And can I tell you, I have never seen language like this ever in the reinstatement of a public servant in all of my entire life. I mean, it was just so amazing. I expect these men to come in. They're probably going to heal the sick and raise the dead when they're done. I'm going to read it for you. Let's take a call, though. Good morning, caller. You're on. Caller, you there?
Hello.
Hey, morning.
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Miller.
Hey, 52.
Yeah, I like your political humor, you know, but something you said that drew me to call. What happened is, you know, as far as the compliance, and so it's the same thing with the vaccine, nobody can say no.
Mm-hmm.
So we liken that to the cabinet, right? So common sense should show us that if you take a cowboy 200 years ago and put him today, he'll be wondering what's going on. So compliance and silence breeds totalitarianism, as we saw under the last regime.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I would prefer Dr. Sands, or who seems to be more sincere with the Bahamian people, but he seemed that he conformed to the pressure, but he doesn't, or Loretta, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I would also like to see a law enacted, you know, like how they disclose their assets before being in the House of an MP, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to see a law enacted where they disclose it after, because it seems to me as if they are enriching themselves, because some people was valuing less and then they valuing more. So you'll have to be able to document this. Otherwise, we know what's going on in between. You can read between the lines. Have a good day, brother.
Appreciate it. Let me read this letter. This is for immediate release. Royal Bahamas Police Force, immediate press release. R.E., Assistant Commissioners of Police, A.C.P., return to active duty. And I want you to listen to the language, right? One thing I like is when they polish the brass, right? I am elated to announce that Assistant Commissioner Clayton Fernando, Assistant Commissioner Lehman Delavaux, and Assistant Commissioner Kendall Strawn shall return to active duty at the Royal Bahamas Police Force on September 27th, 2021. I am extremely pleased to have these officers rejoin the ranks and become a part of my executive team as we continue to address the scourge of crime, drugs, and the proliferation of firearms on our streets. These men are well respected and hold a wealth of knowledge and experience which will definitely be an asset to the team. Notably, Clayton Fernanda has extensive experience in criminal investigations and operations. Lehman Delavaux has vast experience in policing throughout the force. And Kendall Strawn has extensive experience in criminal investigations both locally and internationally, where he is well respected. I enthusiastically welcome these honorable men to make a positive and impactful difference in our country as we rebuild and move forward in creating safer communities throughout the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Man, isn't that... He almost sounded like he would take them to lunch and buy them drinks. I've never heard somebody talk so well about these public officers we talk about, you know. I mean, he enthusiastically welcomes them back. And by the way, they had all of this experience before we send them home to do nothing for 3 years, right? With their full salary and the full car with gas in it, right? And we also sent them to, so where we send them to? Ministry of Health and the boys' school and one bunch of other foolishness we do with them over the 3 years, right? And now this commissioner's tone seems to be turning all the way down. Like when you soak white rice. I can't hear no fire in his voice. He enthusiastically. It's the part I like is when he read off their credentials. Because, you know, it kind of sounded like he was looking for something to say, but Lehman Delavaux, but he couldn't really figure out what to say. Oh, yeah, he's an all-around police. I like him. He's all around. I'm bringing him back because he's the best police at policing when it comes to being a policeman. I got to read that line again. Notably, Clayton Fernanda has extensive experience in criminal investigations and operations. Lehman Delavaux has vast experience in policing throughout the police force. And Kendall Strawn has extensive experience in criminal investigations, both locally and internationally, where he is well respected. And that's why I tell y'all, let's make Ken Strawn commissioner of police and stop playing around here, because how much of them y'all know have vast experience both locally and internationally? This is why I say Ken Strong. 3 cheers for Ken Strong. Let's take another call, Kermit. Come on, Nicole, you're on.
Good morning, Mr. Miller.
Wow, hello, how are you?
Mr. Miller, this is my name is Darren Lewis Stubbs.
Hello, Darren Lewis Stubbs.
Mr. Miller, Consecutive administrations, they've always choose a member of parliament, say, for the Minister of Youth, Sports, and Culture. Mr. Miller, I look at it as three failed portfolios about to happen. The reason is you have the Minister of Sport, you have the Minister of Youth. That Minister of Youth should be dealing with youth, dealing with bullies in school, peer pressure. We have kids packing groceries after school. Why? We have child labor laws worldwide, you know. My kids are not allowed to do that type of stuff. Mr. Miller, if we have the minister of youth, you're dealing with incest, dealing with child pregnancy, dealing with all the youth problems that children have, even at home, even some kids going to school, they don't want to go on the government food program because they shame. The minister of youth, that's a separate portfolio. The minister of sports, what about our sports academy? One of our islands. You mean that the PE teachers can pick these kids up and say, listen, they're special in this area. So we can have a sports academy on one of the family islands and have them properly trained, not that when these kids get off from school, they go into McDonald's, they go into Wendy's, they go into Mamusha. I'm not saying anything wrong with those companies, but I'm saying how to feed our kids, how to groom our kids, how to really look at our kids and train our kids as being professional athletes. That's the Ministry of Sports. Not only deal with culture, we don't have no culture in our country. Where is our culture? We don't have the egg and spoon race. We don't have the cultural nonsense. We don't have the junior junkie who have kids after they finish school. Some of them are 17, 18, whatever. You mean tell me downtown Nassau and that downtown that the tourists can buy whistles and little cowbells and have a junkie who rush out and grab me and bring their tarts and Benny cakes and guava jam and stuff from over the hill, downtown to sell, downtown Nassau with no cars moving?
I don't disagree with you, caller. What I will say is that I think the Ministry of Youth is intellectual. I think anyone who thinks, I have to learn how to say these things. I think anyone who thinks that the Ministry of Youth makes sense obviously only does so as a part of an intellectual masturbatory escapade, because it literally turns out to be nothing more than smart people talking about smart ideas that never materialize into anything that is of any benefit other than to make themselves feel good. Hopefully you like the way that I said that. All right. But I thought that the Ministry of Culture should have gone with the Ministry of Tourism. I think that just makes sense. Plus, tourism generates its own money and can kind of help limp culture along. And the Ministry of Sports, well, you know, I wanted to put sports with health because, again, I think that is another lion's share budget item. And that, if you created a national, if you could created a national fitness policy, it would help the national prescription drug and national health policy. You see where I'm going with that? And you could kind of create the academy, like you said, that takes super athletes and they do whatever they do on the world stage, but you kind of get the whole population to a point where they know where facilities are, they know how to use them, blah, 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 blah. That's kind of what I had in mind. So let me read a couple more of these text messages. This one here says, good morning, good afternoon, Mr. Miller. Did you hear what the Prime Minister said when I asked about the size of his cabinet? His response was he needs all hand on deck to fight with the hospital and COVID problem. Some of those portfolios tie into each other. I don't care what he says. I still think it's a ridiculously large cabinet. This one here says, what happened to Sugarfoot? Well, Sugarfoot and Soft Hands, you know, I really hope Anton listens to you. His one-way outlook on politics will turn a lot of people from taking anything he says seriously. He could actually stop calling the shows now. The PLP is the government. He doesn't need to lobby for them because they have power and he could kind of go help them do some work. That'd be great. This one here says, Anton is hurting his party, making people think twice. Sir, I am very disappointed in this government already. I read this already. P.S. I have created a database to monitor every word and every move they make. I will hold them accountable. That sounds like a lot of time. Everyone keeps saying Dr. Sands would be a good PM. Personally, I do not think so. That's fine. We allowed to have those personal opinions. Morning, why do you imagine the Governor General is not smiling in any of the photos while presenting? That's his face. He can't fix that. Good morning, Leyvon. Great show as usual. One pet peeve, not a fan of your closing statement. I think you need to let someone write another one for you. It does nothing for your intellectual prowess. Okay, my closing statement, what do I say? I'll work on it. Let me see if I can work on it for you. Mr. Ken Strawn, shot an unarmed suspect after he was on the ground, subdued. I wish the family can call in. He needs to stay off the force just for that. Okay, was he found guilty in a court? Strawn doesn't have people skills for any position. Please leave that. This is in English. This says, Fernanda is next, bro. Now, I want to laugh at this text. This one says, you want to laugh at me, Kermit? Want to hear something really funny? This one says, the FNM need to get Branville McCartney back. Ha, 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 ha. Let me laugh out loud. Ha, ha. Y'all got to be kidding, man. Branville McCartney is done in this country with any sort of, without having to worry about being chastised about it publicly, he's Governor General, which he should have taken when him and Loretta Butler-Turner had that sweet deal going on when they snatched power. He should have said, listen, Laurie, I can let you be Prime Minister. I won't be Governor General immediately. Bang. And he could have gone up there. He had soft hair and brown eyes. And he could have just go around with that smile and shaking hands and waving. And people would have loved him as our Governor General. And we would have said for the first time in 40 years, we haven't appointed a Governor General that was over the age of 60. And we would have been correct. And everybody would love him. Yeah, ha, 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 Branville McCartney. It'll never happen. Great show as usual. The former PM ain't listening to you. Your song, the only thing you accomplished by playing that song is a mango skin gal. Break your heart, you end up counting lamppole or crying while counting lamppole. Question, how come only me one did not know PM Brave Davis' name is a nickname and not his real name? I don't know. It's because when they write it in the newspapers, they don't put it in the inverted commas. Anyway, that's my time. You know the rule, it's Friday. Man, y'all do everything in y'all power not to kill nobody. Greater than that, make sure nobody don't kill you. And if you do that, I'll see you back here on Monday. Y'all stay safe out there. I'm Leyvon Miller. This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, the station for fresh news and smart talk. Don't move. They've got the news next.
Oh, glory. Glory.
Hands to the heavens. No man,
this is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.